Good evening, everyone. We are so glad you're here. We're getting started just a couple of minutes early, and I wanted to welcome you to our third message of our four-part series entitled Fire Rekindled. And looks like we have a great group already here. Teresa, welcome. Glad you're here. Sagrario, glad you're here. Roxanne, how's it going? Hope you had a great week. Mike and Vicky, welcome. Bruce, good to see you, brother. And I know we have others that are hiding without being in the group chat, which is no problem at all. But we're so glad that you have joined us this Thursday evening. It's a great opportunity to come together and study God's Word. And I just want to say thank you. You could be watching television. You could be getting some more work done. You could be taking a nap or going to sleep. But thank you for joining us here for our third part in this message. Tonight's message is entitled The Candle, and we're going to be diving deeper into the holy place, and I'm excited about our message. Before we start, I just want to ask you the question, how are you? How are you? I hope you're doing well. I hope you had a blessed week. I know that there is so much going on. It seems like when you watch the news, there just is more and more, and there's a lot of unrest still. Not sure what the future holds, but I am glad that God holds the future. One of my favorite songs that we sing to our children is He's Got the Whole World in His Hands. Know that song? He's got the whole world in His hands. Beautiful song. And I'm so thankful that God has the world in His hands. So let's go ahead and pray to our Creator and Maker and thank Him for just holding the world in His hands. And I want to welcome Amy. Glad you're here. Martha, glad you're here. Andrew, what's up, brother? Cindy, glad you're here, sister. Text a friend, say, hey, join us as we study God's Word. So why don't we go ahead and bow our heads for a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your faithfulness to us. I want to ask that you would please come into our hearts as we spend time in God's Word. Father, we recognize that the times that we're living in truly are pointing to your soon return. We don't know when you're going to come, but Lord, we look forward to that day. And Lord, we just want to thank you for the peace that you give. I was having a Bible study this past week, and Lord, I was talking about, we were talking about that as a group, just how when we study your word, we have joy. When we put our lives in your hands, we have peace. And I thank you for that. And I believe, Lord, that you're going to give us peace tonight, and we thank you for that. So we love you. And we just pray and ask these things in your name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Well, one night, the captain of a Greenland whaling vessel found himself surrounded by large icebergs out in the Arctic Sea. And fearing that at any moment he could be grounded to death, he decided to just stay put and not go anywhere, waiting till morning to hopefully get a little more light to see ahead of him. Well, when morning came, he was peering out in the mist into the deep, cold sea, and he noticed in the distance a strange, mysterious vessel sitting in the water not too far from him. He had drifted in the night close to this strange, mysterious vessel, and so he called some of his crew members together, and they got together a little rowboat, and they rowed out calling out, "Who's there? Reveal yourself." But there was no response. They came closer to this mysterious, strange vessel, shouting, "Hello, is anyone there?" And still, there was no response. So as they got closer to this vessel, their little rowboat touched the corner of it, and they peered through the porthole there, and they could see the captain standing at his desk as though he was writing in his journal, but the captain didn't move. And as they boarded the ship, they saw that there were other sailors that didn't move. Everyone on that ship was completely frozen. They found sailors that were in their hammocks completely frozen. And evidently, according to the journal, as they read through the journal, the ship had been floating frozen through the Arctic for 13 years. Friends, I have a question for you. Do you feel frozen? Do you feel spiritually frozen? Many of us are like that frozen ship with a frozen crew. We have the appearance of life. It seems from the outside perspective, there we are. You can see our clothes. You can see the outside. But as you get closer, we're frozen on the inside. Friends, you can be sailing from Sabbath to Sabbath or from prayer meeting to prayer meeting or Thursday night to Thursday night Bible studies with Pastor Jeff. You can be sailing from one week to the next, one weekend to the other, but still be spiritually frozen inside. Friends, there have been times in my life where I have been spiritually frozen. I'm going through the motions. I go to church because I know that I should. I read my Bible because I know that I should. Or maybe I am not reading my Bible at all or not praying at all. And maybe, friends, there are some of you tonight that feel frozen inside. And I want to ask the question, how do we become, we'll use the word, how do we become fired up? The title of our series, this four-part Bible study series, is Fire Rekindled. How do we get that fire in our bones yet again? How do we no longer be part of the frozen chosen? Well, friends, I believe that the answer to that question is the candle, the seven-lamp candlestick found right there in the holy place of the wilderness sanctuary. You can see on the screen as it's zoomed in just a little bit, but the candlestick would have been on the south side of the holy place wall as the high priest walked into the holy place, the first department of the sanctuary before he came to the veil that separated the holy place from the most holy place. And I want us to go ahead, friends, and turn in our Bibles to Exodus chapter 25, verse 31 through 37. Exodus chapter 25 and verse 31 through 37. We want to welcome all the others that have joined us here. Glad that you are here. We amazingly got started right on time, but you haven't missed anything yet. Glad that you are here with us. Exodus chapter 25, verse 31 through 37. As I've mentioned before, now that we're our deeper Bible students and scholars, I'm just putting the reference up on the screen, and you can either look it up on the internet or your own Bible. We'll go through the verses quickly, but we're going to do a good old-fashioned Bible study tonight. So Exodus chapter 25, starting in verse 31, it says, "You shall also make a lampstand of pure gold. The lampstand shall be of hammered work, its shaft, its branches, its bowls, its ornamental knobs and flowers shall be of one piece." And friends, as we continue to read about the intricate, detailed work of the seven-lamp candlestick, I want you to notice how beautiful it would have been. Absolutely beautiful descriptions in the next few verses. Verse 32, "Six branches shall come out of its sides, three branches of the lampstand out of one side, three branches of the lampstand out of the other side. Three branches shall also be made like almond blossoms on one branch, with an ornamental knob and a flower, and three bowls made like almond blossoms on the other branch, with an ornamental knob and a flower. And so for the six branches that come out of the lampstand. On the lampstand itself shall be four bowls that are made like almond blossoms, each one with an ornamental knob and flower. There shall be a knob under the first two branches, a knob under the second two, and the third two, according to the six branches. Their knobs and their branches shall be of one piece, and it shall be of one hammered piece of pure gold. You shall make seven lamps for it, and they shall arrange its lamps so they give a light in front of it. And its wick trimmers and their trays shall be of pure gold, and it shall be made of a talent of pure gold with all these utensils," finishing up verse 40, "and see to it that you make them according to the pattern which was shown to you on the mountain." God gave Moses this pattern. He gave him a spreadsheet. Hey, this is how it's going to be built. Every home is built with a set of architectural plans. And God gave Moses a set of architectural plans based off of the heavenly sanctuary. And here we find this beautiful candlestick found in the holy place of the sanctuary. But we want to ask the question, what does it mean? What does it mean? And if you remember this slide, this was last week, we looked at how each element of the sanctuary represents Jesus at the end of the day, right? Jesus left his throne room on high. Number two, he was the bread of life, the table of showbread. Jesus was the light that came into the world. The lamp candlestick. He lived a life of prayer. We talked about how the altar of incense represents prayer. And Jesus was baptized. The priests washed themselves in the bronze laver, number five. And number six, Jesus was crucified. He was the lamb that was crucified on Calvary for you and for me. And in that picture that you see there, number three, Jesus is the light that came into the world. And that is exactly what we find in John chapter 8, verse 12. I put this one on the screen for you. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. So friends, at the end of the day, every single piece of furniture in the sanctuary represented Christ. It pointed forward to Christ. Remember, friends, how we looked at in Revelation of Peace that the ceremonial law pointed forward to Jesus, right? And when Jesus died on the cross, we no longer had to sacrifice a lamb. But when we look at the sanctuary, we can learn deeper details about his salvific work is the word that I'm looking for. And so Jesus, represented by this candlestick, he is the light of the world. But remember, friends, what else Jesus said? Do you remember this? Matthew 5:14. Let's go ahead and turn in our Bibles. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14. Do you remember what Jesus said? Not only is he the light of the world, but we should be the light of the world, right? We should extend his light to other people. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 14. You are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. You are a light of the world, a city that's set on a hill cannot be hidden. And again, I'm sorry, but I keep on thinking of all these children's songs. Have you heard of this one? This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine. Wonderful song. Another part of the verse says, don't let Satan blow it out. I'm going to let it shine. And we should, as Christians, it's not our light, it's Christ's light, right? We don't have any light in us. Our righteousness is like filthy rags, the Bible says. But as Jesus, the light of the world, is living inside of our hearts, and it's incredible that Jesus, the glorious Son of God, is not only able to, but willing to live inside of our clay hearts, that Jesus shines out, right? I keep on thinking of kids' songs, right? There's another song that talks about letting Jesus shine out. Shine out today, shine out always, shine out of my heart, Lord Jesus. Shine out of my heart. Man, let's see if we can go for a record. How many kids' songs can Pastor Jeff think of? I've already thought of three. We'll see if we can keep on going with that theme today. But Jesus wants to have his light shine out of our hearts. And so in a very real sense, the seven-lamp candlestick represents us being the light of the world, right? We need to shine that light to other people. And that candlestick, in a very literal sense, was the light that illumined the entire holy place. I mean, you think about it. They didn't have electricity. They didn't have nice LED lights. They didn't have any Christmas lights hung up around the edges of the holy place. This candlestick literally was the light that illumined the entire holy place. And friends, I believe that Jesus wants his light to illumine the world around us. But let me ask you another question. How did that light burn? How did that light burn? Well, let's go ahead and go to Leviticus chapter 24. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. And we're asking the question, how did the light burn? The light that illumined the holy place. How did that burn? And to apply it to us, how do we let our light shine? How does our light burn to others? Well, let's notice in Leviticus chapter 24 and verse 2, what the Bible says. Where is it here? There we go. It says, command the children of Israel that they bring to you pure oil of pressed olives for the light, to make the lamps burn continually. Now, there's a couple things that I want to bring to your attention. First of all, do you remember that word continual? Last week, a week ago on Thursday, we talked about how the table of showbread was put out continually. We talked about how the incense was burned continually. And does anyone remember the Hebrew word? I don't have it on the screen. See if you can think back to last week that we used to describe continual. It's the Hebrew word tamid, essentially transliterated T-A-M-I-D, tamid. And it means continually or regularly on a continual basis, all right? Not periodically or every so often, but all the time. And so these candles were burning all the time. And I think that's a great application for us, that we should let our light shine, or Christ's light shine through us all the time. Not just when we go to church, not just out in public, but when we're by ourselves, when no one else is watching, when we're in front of our TV screen and no one else is there, in front of our phones and no one else is there, in front of our family. We should let our light shine continually. But notice another detail found here in Leviticus 24, verse 2. It says, command the children of Israel that they bring to you pure olive or oil of pressed olives. So there was olive oil that was not just allowing that light to burn. That olive oil was the method and the means of the light that was burning. And you see, friends, that oil is a very important part, not just of the candlestick, but of the entire Bible. And what we're going to be looking at tonight is not just us shining our lights, right? We're primarily going to be spending our time looking at that oil. What does that oil mean, and how does that apply for us? Because I can tell you, go witness, go let your light shine, but I want to know how. Well, friends, turn with me to Zechariah chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Zechariah is in the Old Testament. It's in the minor prophets, right? You get to Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zechariah, right? Zechariah is after Haggai. Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 4, and I'm repeating them out loud, so hopefully that'll help you. Zechariah chapter 4, and I'm going to go ahead and jump into this, verses 1 through 6. It says, now the angel who talked with me came back and wakened me as a man who's waking out of his sleep. And he said to me, so an angel's talking to Zechariah, saying, what do you see? And Zechariah said, I'm looking, and there's a lampstand of solid gold with a bowl on top of it. Where have we seen bowls and a lampstand? This is the lampstand of the holy place. It says, and on the stand there were seven lamps with seven pipes to the seven lamps. So there's a few additional details. This is in a vision that Zechariah is having, Zechariah the prophet. Verse 3, two olive trees are by it, one to the right and the other to the left. So I answered and spoke to the angel who talked with me, saying, Lord, what are these? So notice, friends, here are two olive trees, and the olive trees are essentially supplying all of the oil to that candlestick. But check out verse 5. It says, so the angel who talked with me answered and said to me, do you not know what these are? And I said, no, Lord. So verse 6, he answered and said to me, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Friends, I'm going to suggest to you, and I'm not the only one that thinks this, that oil in the Bible often represents the Holy Spirit. Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Let me show you, and I wish I could show you more, but just two more passages to help illustrate this. Let's go to Exodus chapter 30. Exodus chapter 30 and verse 30 and 31. And it says, and just by way of introduction, the title of this passage is the Holy Anointing Oil. So this is God's instructions is how they were to anoint the high priest Aaron. It says, verse 30, you shall anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them that they may minister to me as priests. And you shall speak to the children of Israel, saying, this shall be a holy anointing oil to me throughout your generations. So they would anoint the high priest with oil. But what did that oil represent? Well, friends, if you go to Acts chapter 10, and I have the verse on the screen for you, Acts chapter 10. Well, I should say the reference is on the screen. I'm making you look it up. We're getting our finger exercises, right? My brother is a pianist. He took piano performance in college, and he used to do finger exercises, right, to loosen up those appendages. So we're getting some finger exercises. Acts chapter 10 and verse 38. Here, Jesus is being anointed, but notice he's not being anointed by oil. How is he being anointed? Acts chapter 10, verse 38. It says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth. Right? Jesus is our high priest. Aaron, the high priest, was anointed with oil. But God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. So in the New Testament, we see, friends, that God anointed people with the Holy Spirit. And the oil in the Old Testament represented the Holy Spirit. And so it was a tangible way of teaching them that God wants to anoint us with the Holy Spirit. So now I want you to turn with me to Luke chapter 11. So what we've seen so far, to do just a little bit of a summary work, is that the candlestick in the holy place represents, at the end of the day, Jesus being the light of the world, right? Every single part of the sanctuary points to Jesus. But the Bible tells us that not only is Jesus the light of the world, but he wants us to be the light of the world, not with our own light, but with Christ's light. But how do we burn, right? How do we get that light to shine? And in the Old Testament, we find in the holy place that they burnt a fresh olive oil to let those lights shine. That's how they did it in the ancient world. And that oil represents the Holy Spirit. And I can show you more passages. We're going to mainly focus on that aspect, though, the Holy Spirit. And I'll tell you why, friends. I want to suggest to you there's going to be four reasons why I think that it is absolutely crucial we need the Holy Spirit. I don't hear enough pastors, friends, talking about the Holy Spirit. And we need desperately the Holy Spirit. And we need to be asking God to send His Holy Spirit very intentionally, specifically. I'm not just saying, you know, thinking about it, but we need to literally be praying, God, give me the Holy Spirit. And I want to give you four reasons why that's the case. But I believe, friends, that the Holy Spirit is truly the fire that can rekindle our walk with God and can help us not be the frozen chosen anymore, like that Greenland whaling vessel. So hopefully you're with me in Luke chapter 11. I was talking, so I didn't get to be there. So I'm giving you a little more time to look it up. Hopefully you're already there, Luke chapter 11. And here in Luke chapter 11, Jesus gives a three-part lesson on prayer. It's a powerful lesson. And verses 5 through 8, Jesus gives just a wonderful parable. Check this out. Jesus said to his disciples, which of you shall have a friend, and you go to him at midnight? So what time of day? Midnight. And you say to him, friend, lend me three loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has come to me on his journey, and I don't have anything to set before him. And verse 7, the neighbor will answer from within and say, do not trouble me, the door is now shut. My children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give it to you. But I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. So friends, notice this parable here, what we have going on. In the parable, it is not just late at night, it's actually early in the morning. It's midnight. Now, not many of us get knocks on our doors at midnight. But imagine, friends, that you are in bed, you're sleeping. And lately, my wife and I have definitely in bed by midnight, right? When you have small children, they wake up at 5:30 in the morning, you know, you want to be in bed by 9 o'clock, right? So by midnight, we're definitely in bed. But imagine getting a knock on the door in the middle of the night. And you go to the door, who's there? Hey, it's our friend, right? And let's say, you know, it's my friend Andrew. Andrew's watching tonight, Andrew Gonzalez. So Andrew's at my door at midnight. Andrew, what do you need? Oh, Pastor Jeff, please, I just had some friends come by and visit. They were driving all night from Arizona to get here, and I don't have any food in my cupboards to give them. Can you please give me some food? Do you have anything? And at first, I'm annoyed, right? Just like the friend in the parable. Ah, it's late, it's midnight. I can't be bothered. But then Andrew keeps on knocking. Please, please. And the Bible doesn't call us or doesn't tell us how much longer he persists or how much longer his neighbor resists. He doesn't tell us how much longer the friend persists knocking or how much longer the neighbor resists answering the door. But at some point in time, he answers the door and gives him some bread, right? Now, this is a fascinating parable, and I believe that we can find some very valuable lessons on prayer from this parable. And we're going to read exactly what this parable means, but one commentary on this parable puts it this way. This is from Christ's Object Lessons, page 140. It says, "The selfish neighbor in the parable does not represent the character of God." That makes sense, right? God isn't selfish. "The lesson is drawn not by comparison, but by contrast. A selfish man will grant an urgent request in order to rid himself of one who deserves his rest. Here, take the bread. But God is the opposite. He delights to give. He's full of compassion, and he longs to grant the requests of those who come unto him in faith." Isn't that beautiful, friends? I think that I would most certainly agree with this author that this parable is a comparison of, or parable of contrast, right? God isn't, you know, he's not selfish and say, ah, here, take it. No, he loves to give, right? So Jesus is contrasting, saying, listen, a selfish person, yeah, would give you, right? He would give you. But how much more would God delight to give? And to further illustrate, I think, my point and the author's point that you just read, that this parable is one of contrast. Notice the next section of this prayer lesson. This is Luke chapter 11, verses 9 through 13. So in the very next verses, Jesus tells a different parable. And notice what he says. He says, "So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Right? If he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Verse 12, or if he asks for an egg, will he offer a scorpion?" I love this, friends. Before we get to verse 13, Jesus gives this beautiful analogy. He says, listen, guys, I mean, come on. You guys are sinful human beings. But how many of you, if your son came up to you and asked for a piece of bread, would hand him a snake and say, you know, here, eat that, kid. You hungry? Here's a rock. Suck on that for a little bit. Of course not. Right? My three sweet children, Judah, Levi, and Eden, like food. And Levi, my middle child, especially loves food. He's a social eater, right? I mean, the moment that often, right, I'll come home later, maybe, you know, I'll drop in for lunch in between my busy day, but I am not able to eat with the family, right? The kids ate earlier because they're hungry at like 11, 11:30. Maybe I stop in at 12:30. So I'm eating there. And of course, Levi, even though he just ate an hour ago, comes up. Dad, are you eating? What are you eating? Can I have a bite? He loves to eat. And friends, if Levi came up to me and said, Dad, I'm so hungry. There might be times where I say, hey, you just ate. Let's wait a little bit. Right? But if he's truly hungry, I'm not going to give him a rock or a leaf, right? Hey, here's a vegetable. Suck on this piece of grass for a little bit. No, I'm going to give him some food. Why? Because I love him. And Jesus is saying this, friends. If an earthly, sinful, imperfect, broken human being loves his child enough to give him what he asked for, how much more will our Heavenly Father give to those that ask him? Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock on God's door, and it will be open to you. Friends, this is absolutely brilliant, and it's powerful, because it tells me this, that I can go to God at any point of the day, at any time of night, and God always listens. He's not like that annoyed neighbor. Why are you here? Ugh. Jeff's praying again, guys. Come on. Man, can't believe this kid. No, he delights and says, hey, heaven, listen up. Jeff is here again on his knees. My child is here again on my knees. Oh, I'm so glad they're here. All right, let's listen in. What's he asking for? You guys, he needs some strength to resist temptation. Let's give it. Oh, he needs some extra love and patience for his kid. Let's give it. He needs wisdom to know how to take his test, students, or how to administer, you know, whatever it may be for your job. God loves to give. And friends, if you look at that parable, verses 9 through 12, the word ask is used over and over again. Ask, 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 right? And you could use the word seek and knock are very similar. Ask, seek, knock, ask, 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 ask. Well, what are we supposed to ask for? We're supposed to ask God, but what are we supposed to ask for? And this is key, friends, because there is something very specific that God is wanting us to ask him for. And we could give a lot of answers. Well, God, he wants us to ask him for grace. He wants us to ask him for love. He wants us to ask him for forgiveness. Yes, all of those things. But I would say even above those things, paramount to those things, more importantly than those things, and I'll tell you why. I want to argue to you tonight, try to convince you, hopefully you'll see it from Scripture, that there is one specific gift that you and I need to be asking for continually, to need, all the time, on a regular basis. What is that gift? Verse 13 tells us, friends. Luke 11, verse 13, it says, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. Now, I'm going to change the next part of verse 13, and I want you to notice what I change it to. How much more will your Heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Is that what it says? I'm going to read it again. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Is that what your Bible says? That's not what my Bible says. It says, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Friends, I want to suggest to you that the most important gift that we need to be asking for from God on a daily basis is the Holy Spirit. We need to ask. We need to ask. We need to ask. We need to ask. We need to seek. We need to knock. We need to persistently. God is teaching us persistence in prayer and specifically praying intentionally for the Holy Spirit. Notice how that same commentary continues. This is page 145 of Christ's Object Lessons. God does not say, ask once and you shall receive. He bids us ask. Unwearyingly persist in prayer. The persistent asking brings the petitioner into a more earnest attitude and gives him or her an increased desire to receive the things for which we ask. And in fact, if you study the Greek of this passage, that word ask is used in the continuous sense. In Greek, there's a way to say certain words and verbs that have an idea of persistency, right? To continuously asking for the Holy Spirit. So friends, this urgent invitation shows us that Jesus is telling us, right? Listen, you're going to miss out if you're not praying for the Holy Spirit. If you're not consistently and unwearyingly praying for the Holy Spirit, you will miss out. And friends, I want to suggest to you today that the way that we become unfrozen, the way that we let our fires be rekindled and our love for God stoked again is through the Holy Spirit. And I want to give you, friends, four reasons why we need to ask daily for the Holy Spirit. And the first reason why we need to ask daily for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you can see it there on the screen, is that the Holy Spirit is how we access the source of all gifts. The Holy Spirit is how we access the source. What do I mean by that? Well, turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians. We're going to
spend some time now in the New Testament. Ephesians after Galatians, right after Galatians. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 18. Notice what it says. It says, "For through Christ we both have access by one Spirit to the Father." So notice, friends, that it is through Christ and by the Spirit that we have access to the Father. The Holy Spirit gains us access. And I'm going to suggest to you that the Holy Spirit gains us access to Christ as well. We're there in Ephesians. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 3, now verse 16 and 17. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 says that He would grant you, according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with might through His Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. So jump back to verse 16. Notice what it says. It says that you would be strengthened through whom? His Spirit. We are strengthened, friends, through the Spirit. And the purpose of that strengthening is that Christ may dwell in our hearts. Right? We're strengthened through His Spirit that Christ may dwell in our hearts. And I want to suggest to you, friends, that the intention, the purpose of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is so that Christ may be in your hearts. Remember how I told you that the only way that our light can shine, because it's not our light, is if Christ is in our hearts. But friends, I want to suggest to you that Scripture tells us that the way that we get Christ in our hearts is through the Holy Spirit. Please turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 15, verse 26. Because this is so important, friends. John chapter 15, verse 26. The Holy Spirit doesn't draw attention to Himself. He's not selfish. He's not saying, "Hey, I want you to pray for me because it's all about me. Look at me." No, the Godhead is constantly deflecting attention. The Father points to the Son. The Son points to the Father. The Spirit points to Christ and to the Father. They're constantly deflecting attention. And look at John chapter 15 in verse 26. Here we are, friends. Notice what the Bible says. It says, "But when the Helper comes," that's the Spirit, "when the Holy Spirit comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, He will testify of me." So the Holy Spirit's job is to testify of Christ. Look here, friends, at John 16, verse 14. So just one chapter over, John 16, 14. It says, "The Spirit will glorify me, for He will take of what is mine and declare it to you." The Holy Spirit will glorify me. So friends, the Spirit glorifies Jesus. So friends, here's what I'm saying to you. If you really want to understand God, if you really want to understand God, if you really want to understand Jesus and His love and what He did for you, you need the Holy Spirit. Spiritual things are spiritually discerned. And God asks us to live by the Spirit, right? The fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, self-control. And the way that we access those fruits are through the Holy Spirit. And in order for all those things to happen, you need the Holy Spirit. Now, I have a question, friends. How many of you today want to say this, "I belong to Jesus"? Anyone else? Not just me, all right? I see your hands through the screen. Not really. But I believe that by faith you're raising your hands. I want to say the same thing, too, that I belong to Christ. I want to say that I am His and He is mine. But how do we belong to Christ, friends? Notice Romans chapter 8 and verse 9. Romans chapter 8 and verse 9. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. Romans chapter 8 and verse 9. It says, "But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you." Now, check out this last sentence of verse 9. Romans chapter 8, verse 9. "Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not His." Wow. When I read that, friends, mind blown. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't belong to Jesus. If you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you're not His. We need, friends, the Holy Spirit. We have to have access to Christ. In order to gain that access is through the Spirit, friends. We need the Holy Spirit. And the reason why is this. Notice this book, Testimonies to the Minister, says this. This promised blessing, if claimed by faith, this promised blessing of the Holy Spirit, if claimed by faith, would bring all other blessings in its train. The power of God awaits their demand and reception. Now, friends, I want you to notice that quotation because it's interesting. It says, the power of God awaits their demand and reception. Now, it almost seems rude to demand something from God, right? God, I demand this. But friends, I want to suggest to you that you can demand from God in a holy way. Demanding from God is not, you know, shaking your fist, I want that, but is saying, God, you promised your Holy Spirit, I ask for it. And by faith, I'm claiming that promise. And that same quotation says, friends, that the Holy Spirit will bring all other blessings in its train. How many of you have seen a train before? I've seen one. Right here in good old Loma Linda and Redlands, I've seen a train. How many of you have ever been out San Timoteo Canyon? You're trying to get back there, and there's a train that goes right through there, and sometimes you're caught right at the train. I remember one time I was going to a Bible study at someone's house that basically lives off San Timoteo Canyon Road. And I was coming from Loma Linda, and I ended up catching this train three times, right? Literally. I crossed one way, and the road kind of curves around and crosses it again. I caught it both places. And then I went down the road, and I caught the train again three times. I definitely saw how long that train was. And there were two or three or four engines in the front pulling this massive long train. And there were a few in the back pushing it as well. But all of those beds, right? All of those different cars that the train was pulling were filled with lots of resources. And the Holy Spirit is the front train, right? It's the engine that is pulling all of the other gifts from God. And the way that we access all those resources is through the Holy Spirit. In Texas, there's a famous oil field called Yates Pool. And many years ago, during one of the American economic crises, there was a sheep ranch owned there by a man named Mr. Yates. However, he was not able to earn enough money to provide a living for himself from his sheep farm. But fortunately, something happened. An oil company came and informed him that there might be an oil deposit on his property. And the company proposed doing a trial drilling, and so he signed the contract. And at 1,200 feet, they found a massive oil deposit underneath the property of Mr. Yates. And it all belonged to Mr. Yates. On the day that he purchased that land, he purchased the rights to the oil. He was a multi-millionaire living in poverty. He was a multi-millionaire, but he didn't know it because he had a whole pool of resources of oil underneath his feet. And friends, I want to suggest to you tonight that you and I have a massive oil field right underneath our feet. And that oil field is called the Holy Spirit. And so many of us, friends, are multi-millionaires living in poverty. We have the Holy Spirit right there at our fingertips. He awaits our demand and reception, but so many people are not accessing the treasure. Maybe one, because they don't know. And maybe you didn't know tonight how important the Holy Spirit was. So maybe it's by ignorance. You just don't know. But friends, others, like myself, I know about the Holy Spirit. But I will admit to you that I don't pray enough for the Holy Spirit. And friends, we need to be daily praying for the Holy Spirit. So first reason why we need the Holy Spirit is because the Holy Spirit is how we access the source of all of these gifts and resources from God. The second reason why we should ask for the Holy Spirit is because Jesus needed the Holy Spirit. What? It's true, friends. Jesus needed the Holy Spirit. The second reason we should ask for the Spirit in the last days is because Jesus needed the Spirit. I'm going to put a bunch of verses on the screen for you, and we won't have time to actually turn there, but I put them on the screen for you. And I want you to notice how often Christ and the Spirit are mentioned together. All right, listen to this. Matthew 1:18. Mary, that's she was found. Mary was found to be with child from whom? The Holy Spirit. So let's pause here for a moment and think about that, friends. And we know this, right? And this is a perfect time to be talking about this because it's the holiday season. I didn't intentionally do that. Well, maybe I did. But I walked out of my house kind of looking like a Christmas tree, right? I've got red and white and green. I love Christmas, one of my favorite holidays. And one of the reasons, friends, is because I love talking about, thinking about, meditating on, praying about, praising God for the incarnation of Christ. That the God of the universe would voluntarily choose for 31 years to become one of us and die on Calvary blows my mind, friends. That he would choose to go from the palaces of heaven to a dirty barnyard stable is amazing. And we know, friends, that the birth of Jesus was a miraculous birth. Mary was to be found with child, not through Joseph. Everyone else thought it was a big scandal, right? These two couples were engaged, Mary and Joseph. They're sleeping with each other. They're having a baby out of wedlock. How scandalous. And Mary's telling everyone, listen, I have not touched Joseph. I did not sleep with him. Right? Because the Holy Spirit provided, friends, the means for Mary to have that child. So if we go back to the screen there, Matthew 1:18, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Notice the second one. The Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him, Luke 3:22. When was this? When did the Holy Spirit descend in bodily form like a dove? At the baptism of Jesus, right? When Jesus was baptized, Acts 10 tells us that he was anointed by the Holy Spirit. And the tangible form of that, God asked a dove, right? And he asked a dove, hey, you're going to, told the dove. He didn't ask him, right? Doves don't have that brain capacity to say yes or no, but he's able to command animals. And he commanded an animal to land on his shoulder. And that was the Holy Spirit, friends. Well, back on the screen, Luke 4:1, number 3, and Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So right after Jesus was baptized, he went into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, went completely without food. And the Bible tells us that the one who led him into the wilderness was the Spirit. He was full of the Spirit after his baptism, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. But look at number 4. This is interesting. And Jesus returned from the wilderness in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, Luke 4:14. So Jesus went into the wilderness by the Spirit, and he left the wilderness by the Spirit. And then look at number 5. In that same hour, he rejoiced in the Holy Spirit, Luke chapter 10, verse 21. And I love that the Holy Spirit brought Jesus joy. And I want to suggest to you, friends, that the Holy Spirit can also bring you joy as well. Friends, every single morning, Jesus was asking for the Holy Spirit. And you know what I found in my life, friends? I have found that if Jesus does it, it's a good idea for me to do it. Anyone else? If Jesus needed the Holy Spirit, I need the Holy Spirit. If Jesus upheld and taught the law of God, I need to uphold and teach the law of God. If Jesus kept the Sabbath, I should keep the Sabbath. If Jesus loved and ministered to people, it would behoove me and it would benefit me to love and minister to people as well. If Jesus prayed to the Father, I should pray to the Father. If Jesus needed the Holy Spirit, I would need the Holy Spirit as well. Here's another song. I promised you another song. It's not a kid's song, but have you heard that song? Be like Jesus, this my song, in the home and in the throng. be like Jesus all day long. I would be like Jesus. I want to be like Jesus, friends. How about you? If Jesus needed the Spirit, I do as well. So number one, the Holy Spirit is how we access the source of all the gifts from God. Number two, Jesus needed the Spirit. And the third reason why we should ask daily for the Spirit is the Holy Spirit is how we prepare for the second coming of Christ. And I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 25. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. First book of the New Testament, first gospel, Matthew chapter 25. And Jesus here tells a fascinating parable. He tells a parable here in Matthew 25 about the virgins. Have you heard this parable? The parable of the wise and foolish virgins. We won't read the whole thing, but in essence, as you very well may know the story, the bridegroom was coming. And in Middle Eastern culture, when the bridegroom was coming, right, the bride and all of the virgins would go out to meet the bridegroom. And here you have these 10 virgins. They're going out to meet the groom. I think I messed up some words there, but the virgins are going out to meet the groom, right? And here they are, friends. Here they are. They're going out to meet the groom. But 10 of them have lamps, and 5 of them didn't bring enough oil. 5 of them didn't have preparations for going to meet the groom. And you know what happens, friends, in the story? 5 of them who carried extra oil, 5 of them who carried extra oil got up in the middle of the night. They said, hey, the bridegroom's coming, he's coming. Let's go meet him. And so they go out to meet him. They had enough oil. They trimmed their lamps. That's how they didn't have flashlights, right? They had lamps that needed oil. And 5 of them didn't have enough oil. And they said, hey, let's go out and get some. So they went out and got some oil, but it was too late. And when they get to the party and knock on the door, let's go ahead and read in our Bibles, Matthew chapter 25. This is verse 11. I'll start in verse 10. It says, and while they went to buy oil, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. Verse 11, afterward the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. Verse 12, but he answered and said, assuredly I say to you, I do not know you. And notice verse 13, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Spirit comes. Friends, all 10 virgins were virgins, meaning biblically, right? We looked at this in Revelation. They had pure biblical beliefs. All had lamps, meaning they all had the Bible. All of them went to meet the bridegroom. They were all looking forward to the second coming of Christ. All of them went to sleep. All of them heard the call and woke up. All of them prepared their lamps. All the lamps were burning. But half of them, notice, their lamps were going out. Half of them did not have enough oil. And when they went in to meet the bridegroom, the bridegroom said, sorry, it's too late. And friends, we've already talked about what the oil represents. It represents the Holy Spirit. And friends, these are solemn words, but I need to tell them to you. Many Christians will not be ready and prepared for the second coming of Christ because they have a deficiency of the Holy Spirit. Friends, if you want to be prepared and ready when Jesus comes, you need the Holy Spirit. Friends, you can have knowledge, you can have talents, you can be a Christian all your life, but that doesn't mean you have the Holy Spirit. You can know about the Sabbath truth. You can be part of God's last day remnant church, but not have the Holy Spirit. Friends, the way that we get the Holy Spirit, Luke chapter 11, is by asking God for the Holy Spirit daily. Daily saying, God, I need your Spirit. One of my all-time favorite quotations about the Holy Spirit is by the late Christian pastor and author, theologian A.W. Tozer. I want you to notice what he says. He says, if the Holy Spirit were taken away from our church today, 95% of what we would do
would continue and no one would notice the difference.
Wow.
But if the Holy Spirit was withdrawn from the early church, then 95% of what they were doing would have stopped and everyone would have noticed the difference. Friends, do you see what he's saying? He's saying that so much of the church today is just going through the motions. You can preach a sermon but not be of the Spirit. You can read your Bible but not be of the Spirit, friends. You need to ask God, God, give me your Spirit that I can have fire for you. Friends, in order to be prepared for the second coming, we need the Holy Spirit. Last reason, last reason why we need to ask daily for the Spirit is we need to ask for the Holy Spirit in order to give the Holy Spirit. We ask to give. And friends, this is absolutely crucial. And actually, before we go to Isaiah 50, verse 4, I want us to think about the parable of in Luke chapter 11 that Jesus told. Why did the friend go to the neighbor at midnight? Was he asking for bread for himself? Was he saying, hey, it's midnight. I'm watching TV and I need a midnight snack. Can I have some bread? No. He was asking for bread for another friend. He said, neighbor, I need bread, but not for myself, but for the neighbor. And friends, let me tell you, we don't just ask for the Holy Spirit for me. God, I need the Holy Spirit because I need you. I have problems in my life. Help me. No, no, no. We ask for the Holy Spirit because other people need God. Turn with me now in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4. Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 4. This is our last Bible verse that we're going to be looking at. Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 4. And this is powerful, friends. Verse 4 says this, "The Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned that I should know how to speak. A word in season to him who is weary. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to hear as the learned." Now, friends, hopefully you're there in Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4, because this is brilliant, absolutely brilliant, what Isaiah says. This is a messianic prophecy, right? Starting all the way back in Isaiah chapter 41, 42, 43, it leads up to Isaiah chapter 53, and it talks about the suffering servant. It's a messianic prophecy. And here this is talking about Jesus, the Messiah to come. And it says, the Lord God has given me, right? The Messiah is talking. The Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned. Why has God given me the tongue of the learned? That I should know how to speak a word in season to him who is weary. He awakens my ear every morning to hear as the learned. So friends, if you didn't catch it, let me tell you this way. The reason that God asked and prayed, and we know, we already read about how God prayed for Jesus needed the Holy Spirit. He prayed for the Holy Spirit. It doesn't specifically mention the Spirit here, but the reason that Jesus prayed was to give a word in season to him who is weary. The purpose of Christ's prayer to his Father were not for himself. God, I am tempted. Please help me. That's a good prayer, but that's not the purpose of Jesus' prayer. God, please help me. I can't do it by myself. That's a good prayer. But that's not all of Jesus' prayers. There are times that he prayed, Lord, let this cup pass from me. I need you. But Jesus prayed that he would give to other people. Notice, friends, from that same book, Christ's Object Lessons, what is told here. Not for himself, but for others, Jesus lived and thought and prayed. From hours spent with God, he came forth morning by morning. Why? To bring the light of heaven to men. Daily, Christ received a fresh baptism of the Holy Spirit. In the early hours of the new day, the Lord awakened from his slumbers, and his soul and his lips were anointed with grace. Why? That he might impart to others. That's what Isaiah 50, verse 4 just said. His words were given him fresh from the heavenly courts, words that might speak in season to the weary and the oppressed. Wow. Right? This commentary, Christ's Object Lessons, is quoting straight from Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4, that Jesus, he needs fresh bread. Right? Have you ever heard the statement that all we are is a bunch of beggars, Christians, all that we are. Christians are just a bunch of beggars pointing other beggars where to find bread. Hey, do you know where to find some good bread? Let me show you. There's this awesome baker named Jesus, and he makes some great bread. Man, I'm so hungry. You want to come with me? Let's go down to the bakery and get some fresh bread. Let's go down and pray. And let's talk to Jesus. Friends, when we pray, we're asking Jesus for bread, right? Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. The reason that we pray is for others. So friends, four reasons. Do you remember it? Four reasons why we pray. Number one, first reason why we pray. And actually, I'll go ahead and pull them up here on the screen for you. Four reasons why we pray. Number one, we pray for the Holy Spirit, not just pray, but we pray for the Holy Spirit to access the source of all other gifts. Number two, the reason we ask daily for the Spirit is because Jesus needed the Spirit. Number three, we need to ask daily for the Spirit is because that's how we prepare for the second coming. And number four, we ask for the Holy Spirit to give the Holy Spirit to others. I want to end with a true, just short, brief story. And it comes from a book that I'm going to tell you about at the end of the presentation. But this story comes from Europe. True story. And there was a teacher that was teaching a small Christian school. She didn't have many students in the school, maybe 20 students. And there was one student that was new. He came that year. He was older, a little bit bigger than the rest of the kids. And she had heard that he was kind of a problem student. And she was praying, Lord, please be with me. Well, right away, she figured out why he was a problem student. He was. He immediately, first day, started causing problems. He was rude. Other kids would come up and talk to him, and he would push them down. He would try to start fights. In fact, just about 6 months into the school year, he actually punched a kid. He was causing problems. And the interesting thing is that this boy actually was a pastor's son. So he knew about God. He knew about the Spirit. Well, this teacher got a book, and I'm going to tell you about it. And this book was all about praying for the Holy Spirit, right? All about praying for the Spirit. And she started praying daily for the Spirit. And in fact, a lot of the verses that we talked about in today's presentation drew some of the material, right, from this book. And she started praying daily for the Spirit. She realized, I need the Spirit. She studied the Holy Spirit in the Bible. I need the Spirit. So she started praying daily for the Spirit. But you know what happened? She realized, I shouldn't just be praying daily for the Spirit. This kid needs to be praying daily for the Spirit, right? At the end of the day, I can't convert people. I can pray for them, but they need to ask themselves. So she gives this book to this kid. He's 13 years old and says, listen, you know you have problems. We all know that you have anger issues. You need to read this book. And who knows what prompted him to, because normally he wouldn't listen to his teacher like that. But he said, okay, I will. And later on, the teacher said, I knew it was the Holy Spirit impressing this young boy to read that book. So he reads the book. And it's all about praying for the Spirit. He starts studying the Bible, praying for the Spirit. And he starts daily asking God for the Holy Spirit. And friends, let me tell you what happened. True story. This is not that long ago, right? Maybe 5-6 years ago. But everybody started noticing a tangible difference in this boy. He started being kinder. He started responding nicely, right? There were still moments where he would, you know, maybe slip up. But after he became hooked on asking for the Spirit daily, by the end of that school year, he was a completely changed boy. Why? Because of the Holy Spirit. A few years ago, this is in the fall of 2018, so not too long ago, just 2 years ago, my wife and I, we started studying about the Holy Spirit. We read this book that I'm going to tell you about. You can get a free copy of it about the Holy Spirit. We are living in Michigan. I was attending Andrews University, a seminary, and as I was there at the seminary, and we started You know, studying about the Spirit and praying daily for the Spirit, my wife and I noticed a difference right away. As we asked God for His Spirit to enter into our hearts and homes, number one, we noticed a difference in our marriage. We are kinder to each other. We noticed that maybe we weren't as impatient. We noticed in our son, Judah, that he responded more to our asking for him for obedience, and he was kinder. And the other thing, most importantly, we noticed that we started drawing closer to God. We did. It was amazing. God was waking me up early in the morning. In fact, Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4 became one of my favorite verses because it says, morning by morning, he awakens me. And I asked God, I said, God, wake me up whenever you want. I stopped setting an alarm clock, and I asked God, God, wake me up. And he started to. I remember getting up, and I look at my phone, and it says 4:30. I never wake up at 4:30. You can ask my wife. I often would go to bed late at the seminary, and I wouldn't want to wake up early, but Jesus would wake me up. We studied the Holy Spirit at this church, the Arden Hill Seventh Adventist Church, last year in January. And the Holy Spirit started doing things. One of, in fact, our church members, he moved to Colorado, but Ken said he started praying daily for the Spirit. And one thing he noticed is that on his drive to work, he would drive all the way, right? I think he had like a 45-minute drive into work every day. And on his drive, he normally would listen to the radio. But as he started praying daily for the Spirit convicted him, you know what? I need to replace that time with the radio with time with God. And he started to replace that time in the car with the radio with prayer. And he would be quoting Bible verses. And he said he noticed a change in his driving. Normally he would get anxious, right? There'd be traffic and someone would cut him off and he would get upset. But God took away all of that. The Holy Spirit did. And friends, I want to challenge you to pray daily for the Spirit. To pray daily for the Spirit. And God is going to do amazing things in your life. I'm going to have a word of prayer, and I'm going to tell you how to access this book, and then I'm going to share one more announcement. But let's go ahead and pray together. Father, I want to thank you so much for my friends that are here. Lord, thank you for their patience. We ended 7 minutes past 8. But Lord, I'm convicted of our need for the Spirit. I need the Spirit, Lord. I need to daily pray for your Spirit. And Lord, we need that fire that illumined the whole holy place. We need that fire in our hearts and our minds and our lives, Lord, to give us a passion for you. You're coming soon. And Lord, we don't want to be like the five virgins that were caught without enough oil. We don't want to be Holy Spirit deficient. And Lord, there's many of us right now that are listening to this that are Holy Spirit deficient. We don't want to be. And Lord, we don't have to be. Right? Because all that you say is just ask. I'll give it to you. You want the Holy Spirit? Just ask me for it. And so, Father, we ask for your Spirit. And Lord, I want to have a moment of silence where each person here can individually ask you for the Spirit. Father, we need your Spirit mightily, Lord, in these last days. And I pray, Lord, for strength and courage as we move forward. For Lord, we realize that we're multimillionaires. And many of us, before tonight, were multimillionaires living in poverty. We didn't know we were multimillionaires. But Lord, we have access to that oil field, and all we have to do is ask. And you will come in, and you will drill that oil and pour it into our lives. We need that tonight, we pray. We ask these things in your name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. All right, friends, here on the screen, you'll see this book. It's called Steps to Personal Revival, Being Filled with the Spirit. It's written by a German layman. Wasn't a pastor. He was a businessman that loved God. And I love that because you don't have to be a pastor to love God. Amen. Anybody can love and study Scripture. And he wrote this book called Steps to Personal Revival. You can see the link on the screen, real easy, steps-to-personal-revival.info. I've also included the link in the description underneath this video on YouTube, so you can access it that way, and I'll go ahead and email it out to you next week as well. But I encourage you, friends, go to that link. You can get this book for free. You can download it as a PDF. If you want like an actual paperback copy of the book, you will have to order it, but it's only a few bucks. But you can order the PDF for free, and you can download it to your iPad or iPhone. And I encourage you, friends, to read through this book. There's so many Bible verses, right? It'll help you study Scripture and understand the work of the Spirit. Powerful little book. All right, friends. I want to invite you to join us in just a couple of days, this coming Sabbath, December 12th. And you can join us a couple different ways. First of all, you can join us for an in-person worship service. And many of you know that the state of California, our public health department here, has advised Californians to, there's a regional, and it's actually not all of California, Southern California, there's a regional stay-at-home order. Because of the rising COVID cases, because our ICUs are they're at that under the 15% level capacity, and thankfully the churches and protests, surprisingly, but religious gatherings are still allowed to meet outside with masks, social distancing. So we encourage you to come if you would like this Sabbath morning at 8:30 a.m. In person, nice and early, get you up in the morning. But if you would like to stay at home, that's no problem, because at 11 a.m. we'll have virtual church service at this same YouTube channel. And I encourage you, you can join us either way. Just to let you know, some of you might have heard, if you came to church this last Sabbath, that tomorrow night we were going to have a Christmas Vespers in person. But because of the stay-at-home council, we thought it'd be best that we don't have that. And so we will not be having anything tomorrow night. But tomorrow morning, either in person, 8:30 a.m., please wear your mask, keep distance. But I believe that we can do it in a safe manner. And of course, if you're sick, encourage you to stay home. And then at 11 a.m., you can join us right here on this channel, worship God on Sabbath. And also, this is not on the screen, but listen to this. This Sabbath afternoon at 4 p.m., and I'm going to send out an email to all of you because I think you'll really like this. This Sabbath afternoon at 4 p.m., a layperson named Dr. Hugo Leone, he's a physician at Kaiser up here in Victorville, and he's regularly attends here Arden Hills. He's passionate about the Bible and about prophecy and the books of Daniel and Revelation. He's going to be giving a Bible study on the book of Revelation. Saturday afternoons, Sabbath afternoons at 4 p.m. It'll probably be from 4 to 5:30, so it's a great way to spend the Sabbath. People are asking me, how do I spend the Sabbath? Well, there's a great way. It'll be on Zoom, okay? It'll be on Zoom. I'll send you the Zoom link, so check your email. But that will be on Zoom, 4 p.m., Saturday, December 12th. And he's just going to go chapter by chapter through the book of Revelation. And I think, friends, that you will absolutely be blessed. I don't have a slide for this, but don't forget that we have one more installment of our Bible study next week. I believe that it's the 17th, December 17th. It's a Thursday, and that will be our last Bible study for this series, The Sanctuary, and we'll take a break for the holidays, but mark that in your calendars at 7 p.m., and hopefully, friends, we'll see you this coming Sabbath morning, but I hope you have a great rest of your night. Pray for the Holy Spirit before you go to bed. Pray for the Spirit when you wake up. And all day tomorrow while you're working, or if you're at home, let's be praying for the Holy Spirit. God bless you, friends. We'll see you Sabbath morning.